Christian, greetings to all our valued listeners and viewers throughout the whole world, more particularly to all Shepherd's Rod believers, and most especially to our beloved brothers and sisters in the United States of America. Good evening, and may the good Lord bless you, brothers and sisters. This subject is entitled The Time Prophecy, and it is our episode number 4. Now, I would like to read Romans 13, verses 11 and 12. And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Romans 13, verse 11 and verse 12. Now I would like to read 2SR. It says here, 2SR page 242. It says, it would have been unreasonable and an injustice to the chosen people of God if He should have left them in darkness concerning the time of the most important event of all church history, the coming of Christ. That part of the long prophetic period of the 2,300 days or years of Daniel 8 verse 14, which pertained to the Jewish nation, namely the 70 weeks or 490 years, they perfectly understood for. It was well known that the 70 weeks of Daniel's prophecy covering the Messiah's advent were nearly ended, and all were eager to share in that era of national glory, which was then expected. Now in this reading, brothers and sisters, the coming of Christ mentioned here, for sure, could not be the visible coming of Christ. It is the coming of Christ brought to view in Daniel 8, verse 14. And the shepherd's rod plainly told us that it would have been unreasonable and also injustice to the chosen people of God if God should left them in darkness concerning the time of the most important event of all the history of the church, and that is the coming of Christ. Now, here in 2SR page 184, it says, the coming of Christ as our high priest to the most holy place for the cleansing of the sanctuary brought to view in Daniel 8 verse 14. The coming of the Son of Man to the Ancient of Days as presented in Daniel 7 verse 13, and the coming of the Lord to His temple foretold by Malachi are descriptions of the same event. And this is also represented by the coming of the bridegroom to the marriage described by Christ in the parable of the 10 virgins of Matthew 25, the Great Controversy, page 426. The description by Daniel applies to the commencement of the judgment for the dead, but the one by Malachi chapter 3 verse 1 to 3 is applicable to the judgment for the living. All of the same event, Day of Atonement, cleansing of the sanctuary. Now, let us now study closely, brothers and sisters, this very important event. The most important event of all the history of the church, which is the coming of Jesus Christ. And the coming of Jesus Christ mentioned is not the visible coming of Jesus Christ, but rather first to the invisible coming of Jesus Christ to the heavenly sanctuary in the most holy place. We already read, brothers and sisters, in Testimonies for the Church in volume 2, page 190 and 191. It says here, Jesus has left us word. Watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at even or at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. And what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. We know that that is found in the book of Mark, Mark chapter 13. It is very important to familiarize that verse. Now let us read Mark 13, beginning from verse 34 to verse 37. Now it says, for the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants and to every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch. Verse 35, watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at even, or at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. And what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. Mark 13, verses 34, 35, 36, and 37. Now, let us go back again to Testimonies for the Church, volume 2, 190. And it says this prophecy concerning these verses recorded in Mark 13, verse 34 to verse 37. It says, we are waiting and watching for the return of the Master, who is to bring the morning, lest coming suddenly he find us sleeping. What time is here referred to? Not to the revelation of Christ in the clouds of heaven to find a people asleep, no, but to his return from his ministration in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, when he lays off his priestly attire and clothes himself with garments of vengeance. And when the mandate goes forth, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still, and he which is filthy, let him be filthy still, and he that is righteous, let him be righteous still, and he that is holy, let him be holy still. Now, here the spur prophecy plainly telling us that the coming mentioned in Mark 13, verse 34 to verse 37, is not the visible coming of Jesus Christ, but rather to his return in his ministration in the most holy place. Now, brothers and sisters, we as shepherds and believers, we are so familiar that in October 22, 1844, that is the first time that Jesus Christ entered to the most holy place. And of course, the word return cannot be applied in that period of time, because the word return indicates to go back, or at least second time, or it might be third time or fourth time. But in October 22, 1844, it can never be applied, because that is the very first time by which Jesus Christ entered into the most holy place. Now, here in 2SR 241, I would like to read this reading. 2SR 241, and it is pertaining to Jude 14 and 15. Now, let's read the statement. Therefore, the prophecy by Enoch commenced its fulfillment in 1844, at which time the Lord came with the names and records of those who are sleeping in the grave. And when the investigation of the dead is finished, then he comes with the names of the living saints, first with the 144,000, and afterward with the great multitude of all nations and kindreds and peoples. And then, Revelation 7, verse 9. Therefore, the complete fulfillment of the prophetic words, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints, shall be realized at the close of provision. Of this coming of the Lord, which is pertains for the dead, William Miller was the messenger, and the message of Elijah the prophet, the messenger of the covenant, is the forerunner for his coming with the living saints, both of the same event, the judgment. Now, in this reading, brothers and sisters, the voice of inspiration is plainly telling that that statement we read in volume 2, 191, when Jesus Christ will return to the most holy place, is answered in this reading in 2SR 241, by which when Jesus Christ entered to the most holy place in October 22, 1844, that is his first coming, bringing the names of the saints who were already dead. But when Jesus Christ will return to the most holy place, the names that he will brought into the presence of God the Father must be the names of the living saints. And that is the time when Jesus Christ will return to the most holy place. Now, the shepherd's rod plainly told us, brothers and sisters, and of course that is the judgment for the living. Now, let us read again the statement in 2 SR 220. 2 SR page 220, it says, "Is there any way whereby we can determine the time of the opening of the seal and the commencement of the judgment for the living? If God so faithfully revealed to the living the commencement of the judgment for the dead, it cannot be possible that he would keep secret the time of the judgment for the living. If he did, we would have no present truth in the time of the last seal. Neither could there be justice in such secrecy, nor could such judgment be legal. Therefore, a revelation of the judgment for the living is of as great importance as the revelation of the gospel itself. For the judgment, blotting out the sins, is the crowning act in the gospel of Christ. Thus we conclude that when the seal is open and the judgment for the living begins, we must know it. The Day of Atonement in its type proves the same, for the Israelites were well informed of the event, their duty, and the consequence." Brethren, this paragraph needs deep concentration and with a prayerful heart that God would grant us the complete understanding of all the things that God wants us to know. Because I do fully believe that according to the word, it is written that in reality, God is anxious. I would like to read that reading in 1 TG number 12. 1 TG number 12, page 18. It says, "If you, God will not let you be deceived." I would like to read this reading. 1 TG number 12, page 18. "Ever have your ears open to any claimant of inspiration if you are not to repeat the history of the Jews?" And this is the portion that I would like to emphasize, that God will not let you be deceived if you really hunger and thirst after righteousness, if you really want to know the truth, for he is anxious that you keep up with his progressively revealed truth. That you keep up with his progressively revealed truth, it says, brothers and sisters, that is the desire of God. Now, to repeat again, I invite all the Bedians to study this paragraph closely and compare it to the entire Shepherd's Rod publications, and not only the Shepherd's Rod publications, but as well as to all inspired writings and also with the Bible, brothers and sisters. Now, let me read to you the Great Controversy. Here in the Great Controversy, it says here, and it is really very hard to imagine, brothers and sisters, that the voice of inspiration is using the term willingly ignorant, and we should not be among those people, according to the Great Controversy, that they were willingly ignorant. Now, I would like to find that statement. The Great Controversy on page 430 and 431. It says, "The condition of the unbelieving Jews illustrates the condition of the careless and unbelieving among professed Christians who are willingly ignorant of the work of our merciful high priest. In the typical service when the high priest entered the most holy place, all Israel were required to gather about the sanctuary and in the most solemn manner humble their souls before God, that they might receive the pardon of their sins and not be cut off from the congregation. How much more essential in this antitypical Day of Atonement that we understand the work of our high priest and know what duties are required of us." The Great Controversy, 431. And remember, that is the determined effort of the devil, according to the Great Controversy, 518. It says here, the great controversy between Christ and Satan that has been carried forward for nearly 6,000 years is soon to close. And the wicked one redoubles his efforts to defeat the work of Christ in man's behalf and to fasten souls in his snares, to hold the people in darkness and impenitence till the Savior's mediation is ended and there is no longer a sacrifice for sin, is the object which he seeks to accomplish. The Great Controversy, page 518. And the shepherds had also plainly told us in White House Recruiter, pages 31 and page 32, saying, "Let us not, however, forget that there is an enemy who is determined to keep God's people in darkness, in ignorance of timely truth." Then it says, "And what more damaging darkness could he seek to keep them in than in ignorance of that which God would have them to know? While their judgment is pending, while they are being weighed in the balances of the sanctuary, none, absolutely none." White House Recruiter, page 31 and page 32. So this, there is no more damaging darkness, rather than you will be in total darkness, in ignorance of what is going on in the heavenly sanctuary. Brothers and sisters, because the shepherd's rod is plainly telling us in track number 3, on page 54, I would like to read it. It says, track number 3, page 54, "For when a person's judgment is pending and he is unaware of the fact, he will be unprepared and unable to stand when his case is investigated." So that is very plain, brothers and sisters, that when a person's judgment is pending and such person is unaware of the fact, then he could not be able to stand when his case will be investigated. And that is why the shepherd's rod is plainly telling that, no, the devil has no concern. It says here in 2 TG number 30, page 15, "Let us once and forever realize that the devil is more shrewd than we can imagine. He is not particular what you believe, so long as he can keep you ignorant of revealed truth." 2 TG number 30, page 15. So the devil is more shrewd than we can imagine. He's not bothered. He is not particular, whatever you believe, brothers and sisters. And the most damaging darkness, that he is very determined that God's people, if possible, they will be in total darkness. What is going on in the heavenly sanctuary, brothers and sisters? More particularly to the Midian. And apology, brothers and sisters, because this is really the reality. The Midian now is quarreling and bickering each other, hostile against each other faith. And they were contending who is the greatest. They were contending who is really the true headquarters. And the devil has no concern. And the devil is laughing because the most important thing that they need to know is the occurrence, what is happening in the heavenly sanctuary. They were in total darkness. I remember the statement in 1 TG. It says here in 1 TG number 51, this is the statement given by the shepherd's rod. Let's read the statement given by the voice of inspiration. "Timely greetings, number 51, on page 5 and page 6. It says, Abel's religion of 6,000 years ago has advanced and expanded to meet the people's necessities of today. This was done only by inspiration adding to it and itself unfolding it. If the church is not commensurably growing and expanding, then how can she be a living church?" And this is the most important part, it says. "And how can she keep up with the signs of the times and with the progress in the sanctuary above?" That is very important. With the progress in the sanctuary above. Now let us read Testimonies for the Church, Volume 6. Let's read the statement. Here in Volume 6, page 404 and 405. It says here, "Brethren, to whom the truths of God's word had been opened, what part will you act in the closing scenes of this world's history? Are you awake to these solemn realities? Do you realize the grand work of preparation that is going on in heaven and on earth? Let all who have received the light, who have had the opportunity of reading and hearing the prophecy, take heed to those things that are written therein. For the time is at hand. Let none now tamper with sin, the source of every misery in our world. No longer remain in lethargy and stupid indifference. Let not the destiny of your soul hang upon an uncertainty. Know that you are fully on the Lord's side. Let the inquiry go forth from the sincere hearts and trembling lips. Who shall be able to stand? Have you, in these last precious hours of provision, been putting the very best material into your character building? Have you been purifying your souls from every stain? Have you followed the light? Have you works corresponding to your profession of faith?" But sometimes I really say that prophecy must be fulfilled. But hoping, brothers and sisters, that we are fulfilling the prophecy in positive side. For example, it was already predicted beforehand in the Bible that one of the 12 apostles will betray Jesus Christ. That prophecy must be fulfilled. But Jesus Christ himself says that woe to him by which the prophecy will be fulfilled. And that is fulfilling the prophecy on the wrong side. That is why here in, I remember in tract number 1, it says here, tract number 1 on page 24, I would like to read this reading. Tract number 1, page 24, it says, "These solemn words may it lay well to heart, and may none let the enemy beguile them with good words and fair speeches on this life and death matter. Fix in your mind the fact that Christ rising up from his mediatorial work cannot be after probation has closed. For note carefully that he is to rise up during the unfolding of truth." So the voice of inspiration made it so plain that we need to fix in our minds that one of the most important events in the vision of the prophet is concerning the time when Jesus Christ will rise up from his mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary. We already explained that the vision of Sister White in Volume 2, page 190, when Jesus Christ will return to the most holy place. And the word "return" indicating that he left the most holy place, then go back. Now, this is one of the fulfillment of that event, that Jesus Christ will left the most holy place. Now, let us read again the statement. We know that Jesus Christ is in the most holy place since October 22, 1844, according to our reading in 2 SR 184. And he entered to the most holy place, bringing the names of those who were already dead, according to 2 SR 241. Now, after that work is finished, but the work mentioned there, brothers and sisters, is the blotting out of sins for those who will be resurrected in the first general resurrection. And that's why here in, let's read again the statement in 2 SR page 164. "When the judgment opened in 1844, as previously explained, the investigation began with the dead. And when that part of the work is finished, then commences the judgment of the living." Now, I hope that God would help me to explain this very important prophecy in a more distinct, brothers and sisters. Now, we already read in tract number 5 on page 109. I would like to read here in tract number 5, page 109. It says here, tract number 5, page 109. "The investigative judgment of the dead consequently takes place in the heavenly temple only. So that is very plain. The judgment that pertains to the dead takes place in the heavenly temple only. And the Shepherd's Rod plainly told us in White House Recruiter on page 20, I would like to read, White House Recruiter, page 20, as the cleansing of the sanctuary in behalf of the dead is necessarily purely a book transaction. That is the reason for its taking place only in the heavenly sanctuary. Hence, the names of the ineligible for the first resurrection are screened from the names of the eligible ones. That heaven's books deal with all aspects of life is evident from Isaiah 56 verse 8, Psalms 56 verse 8, Psalm 69 verse 28, Psalms 139 verse 16, Daniel 12:1, Malachi 3 verse 16, Philippians 4 verse 3, Revelation 3 verse 5, etc. Hence, prophecy reveals that when the judgment was set, the books were opened. Daniel 7 verse 10. White House Recruiter, page 20. Now, the reason why the judgment that pertains to the dead is only or takes place only in the heavenly sanctuary, it's so because it is just a purely bookwork transaction. And that is the reason that the difference between the judgment that pertains to the dead and the judgment that pertains to the living, I would like to read in 1 TG number 11, page 6. It says, the judicial work commences first, 1 TG number 11, page 6. This judicial work commences first among the dead, bookwork only, of course, because that is the only proceedings that pertains to the dead, bookwork, Daniel 7, verse 10. Then among the living, actual bodily separation, cleansing, Ezekiel 9. Actual bodily separation. In 2 TG, number 45, it says, let's read the statement. 2 TG, number 45, page 10. Since this separation of the tares from among the wheat, the harvest, is one and the same work with the judgment of the living, then the only difference between the judgment of the dead and the judgment of the living is that in the former, the names of the wicked are removed from the books above, whereas in the latter, the wicked are bodily swept away from among the living members of the church. 2 TG 45, page 10. But the only thing that I would like to emphasize, brothers and sisters, is that it cannot be construed that the judgment that pertains to the living, that there is no bookwork transaction. Now, which will come first, the bookwork transaction or the actual bodily separation? Now, I would like to read Answerer number 5, page 30. Answerer number 5, page 30. It says, this is the first aspect of the judgment, and being only a bookwork, a work that does not disturb either the dead in the graves or the living in the church, it takes place in heaven. Now, and then it says the second aspect is not a bookwork, but an actual separation of the dead on the resurrection day and the living on the day of purification. The righteous dead are raised and the unrighteous left in their graves. The righteous living are sealed to live eternally, and the unrighteous left to die. Now, this reading, I think it is not difficult to understand, because the Shepherd's Rod plainly telling us here in Answerer number 5, page 30 and page 31, that the first aspect of the judgment, in reality, that statement, the first aspect of the judgment cannot be applied to the dead. Because B.T. Hontef used always the term that if there is first, there must be second. First fruit, second fruit. Because the one we read on White House Recruiter, page 20, is that the only aspect of the judgment that pertains to the dead is bookwork. That is the only aspect in reality when it pertains to the investigative judgment. So that statement in reality is more definitely applied in the judgment that pertains to the living. Now, Answerer number 5, page 30. It says, brothers and sisters, that the first aspect of the judgment is only bookwork. And the Shemur's rod plainly telling us that it does not disturb, for sure, when it is pertains to the dead. It does not disturb them, because when the proceedings that pertains to the dead in the heavenly sanctuary is going onward, the dead are lying unconscious in their graves and they have no knowledge. But the voice of inspiration also plainly telling us, as well as to the living, brothers and sisters. But I would not place myself on the side by which they were unconscious, because that illustration are pertaining to the people that perish in the flood, brothers and sisters. Because that statement in 2TG number 12, page 30, saying to the people that they need to know that their cases in the heavenly sanctuary are on trial. Here in 2TG number 12, page 30, it says, whereas the last two seals, which contain the things that pertain to the judgment of the living, to the people who must know that their cases are on trial. 2TG number 12, page 30. That statement can be easily understood, that God did not require to the dead saints that they need to know that their cases are on trial, because it is illogical and it is also out of value, when in reality, at the time when their proceedings are on trial on the heavenly sanctuary, they were already dead. In answerer number 3 on page 6, it says, answerer number 3, page 6, it is evident that the investigative judgment of the dead affects only the heavenly sanctuary. This is doubly evident when it is remembered that the dead know not anything, according to the Bible, Ecclesiastes 9, verse 5, but are lying unconscious while waiting in their graves for the resurrection day. But when the judgment of the living shall begin, then of necessity the sanctuary on earth will be cleansed from the hypocrites, and the sanctuary in heaven from their names in its records. Both sanctuaries are therefore affected. Answerer number 3, page 6. But the thing that I'm trying to emphasize in this study is that I think the most crucial, the most important thing that we need to know first is that the first aspect of the judgment, which is bookwork, and that is pertaining to the blotting out of names. Brothers and sisters, once our names will be blotted out, then there is no more hope. Our last hope is forever gone. Now, I would like to read to you the Bible verse here in Revelation 13. I will go back to that reading in tract number 5, page 109. Now, here in Revelation chapter 13, it says here, Revelation 13, verse 8, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him. We know the pronoun him is pertaining to the beast, by which in reality, to worship the beast is to worship the devil. And it is called by inspiration as demon worship. And it says here in Revelation 13, verse 8, and all that dwell upon the earth, brothers and sisters, Revelation 13 is a symbolical prophecy. If the sea mentioned here is symbolical, then the earth mentioned here is symbolical. It could not be literal earth. Otherwise, if the earth mentioned in verse 8 is literal, then the earth mentioned in verse 11 must also be literal. Brothers and sisters, the divine principle is that in tract number 5, let us read the statement here. It says, tract number 5, page 41, For if every term is not symbolical, how shall we differentiate those which are from those which are not? Tract number 5, page 41. So that is the divine principle. If the sea mentioned in verse 1 in chapter 13 is symbolical, then the earth in verse 8 must also be symbolical. Otherwise, if the earth is not symbolical, then the earth mentioned in verse 11 is not also symbolical. But it's for prophecy, and the shepherd's rod does not teach that. Now let us read again, brothers and sisters. That is why it is very important to us that we need to address this message to the symbolical earth. Because even in Revelation chapter 7, I would like to read Revelation chapter 7. It says here, saying, hurt not the earth. So the very first mention in Revelation 7 verse 3 is the earth. Hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. So the focal point of hurting is the trees. And first of all, the trees on the symbolical earth. And we address this message first to the symbolical earth, brothers and sisters. Now let us read again in Revelation 13 verse 8. It says, and all that dwell upon the earth, without any exemption, because the word all, without any exemption, that's what it means by the word all. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him. It seems that there is no choice. You will worship the beast represented in reality by the devil, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So this reading plainly indicating that if your name is not written in the Lamb's book of life, in the heavenly sanctuary, brothers and sisters, there is no escape. You will worship the devil. Or in other words, brothers and sisters, the only way that you could be able to escape in worshiping the devil when the evil times will come is to have your names written in the Lamb's book of life. Now here, for example, I would like to read in tract number 12. On page 50, it says, let's read track number 12, page 50. It says, although our first question should be, what shall we do to avoid giving allegiance to the enemies of God? And for sure, the enemies of God is Satan, the devil. And it is pointing to that predicted event, a demon worship, brothers and sisters. Now, let us read again the statement. Although our first question should be, what shall we do to avoid giving allegiance to the enemies of God so as to be found worthy of a place in His kingdom when this evil time shall come? What shall we do? I think the answer is that to have our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life, because the Word of God already declared that all of them, Revelation 13 verse 8, whose names are not found written in the Lamb's book of life, shall worship him, the devil, shall without, brothers and sisters, or there is no escape, unavoidably you will worship the devil. Because the only protection is to have our names written in the Lamb's book of life. And that is why the Shepherd's Rod says in White House Recruiter, let me read to you on page 11. Let's read again the statement. What is of first and supreme importance to each of us, however, is to know for a surety that his name is written in the book. To have this most blessed assurance, you see, to have this most blessed assurance, one must first to know what will keep one's name out of the book and what will put it in. White House Recruiter, page 11. I remember the statement, and I think that is in 2TG, number 7, pages 10 and page 11. Let's read 1TG number 7, pages 10 and page 11. It says, what a solemn time we have come to, brothers and sisters. Reading 2TG number 7, page 10 and page 11. What a solemn time we have come to, brothers and sisters. Do you realize that if you do not now make an effort to put your name in the book, you need to make an effort to put your name in the book. It may be forever too late. It is high time now to expend all our effort to have our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. What will put our names in the Lamb's Book of Life? And what will keep our names out in the Lamb's Book of Life? It's very important to study that, brothers and sisters. Now, I would like to read again this reading in 2 TG number 7, page 10 and page 11. What a solemn time we have come to, brothers, sisters. Do you realize that if you do not now make an effort to put your name in the book, it may be forever too late? And is it not better to have your name there even if the trouble were 100 years in the future? Now is the time to act. Now is the day of salvation brought to you. Today, inspiration pleads, if you hear His voice, harden not your hearts. Only those who heed the revealed word of God will find deliverance and peace. None others will. And that's why I remember B.T. Hodev declared clearly in 2SR page, let me read to you, 2SR page 153, it says, the time of that wholesale deception is at hand. It will take more than great knowledge of theology to escape the most powerful trap His satanic majesty has ever devised. The wonderful miracles will be convincing, and the apparently genuine spirit of worship will bring deep conviction upon those who are subject to be misled. Why is it that they place themselves subject to be misled? Think it thoroughly. I do fully believe that if your name is blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life, you are placing yourself subject to be misled. I would like to read this and then go back to this reading. In 2SR 153, it says, let's continue. As the great men of the world declare its worship through, multitudes will accept their decisions without personal investigation. Add to all of this the following declaration of civil authorities. As many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And we have an overwhelming power which human strength cannot resist for a moment. Only by a prophetic knowledge of the truth, with confidence in Adasset the Lord and in the power of His Spirit, can one escape the wily snares of the devil. 2SR page 153. Only by the prophetic knowledge of the Word of God. And I think that prophetic knowledge of the Word of God is more pertaining, brothers and sisters, to the occurrences in the heavenly sanctuary. Because the Bible made it so plain that all whose names are not found written in the Lamb's Book of Life, all of them shall worship the devil. All of them shall worship the devil. Now, the shepherd's rod is plainly telling us, brothers and sisters, today, I would like to read again, that we need now to make an effort to put our name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Not an effort by which our names will be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life. What is the effort that guaranteed for sure that our names will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life? By which that effort, according to track number 5, let us read track number 5. On page 118, the last page, track number 5, page 118. He who is persuaded and who walks in the light will experience joy inexpressible. He will receive the mark, Ezekiel 9 verse 4, the seal, Revelation 7 verse 2 and 3. Of God's approval, his sins will be blotted out. It did not say his sins is blotted out, but his sins will be blotted out. His name will be ineffaceably written in the Lamb's Book of Life. What does it mean by ineffaceably? Meaning, no longer be erased, brothers and sisters. This is a blessed assurance. That is why in White House Recruiter, page 11, to have this most blessed assurance, what is that act by which, through that act, your name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life ineffaceably, could no longer be erased because of that act? I would like to connect answer number one. Although there are many passages in the Shepherd's Rod stating the same, but here I would like to read answer number one, page 65 and page 66. The Seventh-day Adventist movement was appointed to declare the sanctuary work for God and give glory to Him, for the hour of judgment is come, Revelation 14:7. Then it says, to remove from the Lamb's book of life the names of those who had not filled their vessels with extra oil, and those who had not put on the wedding garment, and those who had not doubled their talents, and also to remove the tares from among the wheat. Now, I would like to focus in this reading the statement, also those who had not doubled their talents. So we have already half answer to the question, what act by which our names will be guaranteed 100% will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life ineffaceably? The answer is double your talents. What act by which our names will be removed, will be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life, if you will not double your talents? Now, that reading can be easily understood, brothers and sisters, that the first talent, your names, is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. But it is conditional. On the first talent, your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. But it is conditional, because if you will not double your talents, your names that had been written in the Lamb's Book of Life will be removed. What is the talents then recorded in that parable? Now, let us read 2TG. Let's read a statement given by the shepherd's rod. 2TG number 11, page 15. The talents in this parable, so this is very plain, because the talents mentioned in answerer number 1, let's go back to answerer number 1, page 65. It says, brothers and sisters, answerer number 1, page 65, also those who had not doubled their talents. Then the quotation is Matthew 25, verse 14 to 30. I would like to read again. Answerer number 1, page 65. Who are they whose names will be removed in the Lamb's Book of Life? Those who had not doubled their talents. Matthew 25, verse 14 to 30. Now let us read 2TG number 11, pages 14 and 15. And the quotation is Matthew 25, verse 14 to 30. So the talents mentioned in answerer number 1, page 65, that if you will not double your talents 100%, your names will be blotted out, will be removed in the Lamb's Book of Life. And once your name is removed in the Lamb's Book of Life, there is no escape. You will worship the beast. You will worship the devil, according to the Bible, right? Revelation 13, verse 8. And to repeat again, the absolute answer of that question in track number 12, page 50, saying, what shall we do, brothers and sisters, to avoid giving allegiance to the enemies of God, which is the devil, when this evil time will come? What is the evil time? That is the image of the beast, right? You remember the statement in track number 12? It says here in track number 12, page 28. It says, track number 12, page 28, let us read the statement given by the shepherd's rod, brothers and sisters. It says here, a full realization of the glorious reward that awaits mankind will even now compel men to shout for joy. And a like realization of the dreadful penalty that awaits all who fail to make God their refuge will cause them even now to weep and gnash their teeth, that all might realistically see these alternative prospects and be impelled thereby to repentance. The Lord has been at supreme pains not only to record a graphic description of the evil which through the instrumentality of the beast Satan has determined upon the whole world, but also aforehand to make of a similar evil a perfect type of the image of the beast. So the evil time is the time when the image of the beast will be in existence. And the only way to avoid giving allegiance that image of the beast or the instrumentality of the devil to worship him is to have our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Because unavoidably, no one could escape. The Bible is very plain. All shall worship him whose names are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And also, that very statement clearly indicating that when the image of the beast is implemented. The only names remain in the Lamb's Book of Life are the names of the sealed ones, the saved ones, the righteous. Because if the names of the wicked will be allowed to remain in the Lamb's Book of Life when the image of the beast is implemented, then they will be among those who will not bow down to the image. But that is not the prophecy, because the wicked will bow down to the image. And as far as the prophecy is thus concerned, it is more pertaining to the 144,000 living saints, as we will proceed in this study. Now, let us now read 2TG number 11, page 15. It says here, the talents in this parable represent the Lord's goods, His timely messages for the people. Each of His servants is represented as being given a certain amount of responsibility, but not beyond their ability. 2TG number 11, page 15. The talents in this parable represent the Lord's goods, His timely messages. So there is a similarity in Matthew 24, verse 45, 46, and 47, when God says that blessed is that servant whom he shall find so doing, feeding God's people meat in due season, that God will make him ruler over all his goods. And accordingly, in 11 symbolic code, number 3, on page 6, it says, the goods is present truth. 11 symbolic code, number 3, page 6. The goods is present truth. Now, what does it mean by double their talents? I would like to read to you 2SR on page 93. 2SR, page 93. It says, thus, not one of these churches have had additional light on the scriptures other than that which was imparted to them by the founders of its movement. I would like to read again the statement, 2SR, page 93. Thus, not one of these churches have had additional light on the scriptures other than that which was imparted to them by the founders of its movement. Now, I would like to give you an illustration, brothers and sisters, very simple. Who is the founder of the Millerites movement? That is William Miller. But for sure, Sister White, double her talents, because she have the message of William Miller, and at the same time, the present truth revealed in her lifetime. So Sister White double her talents. Now, Betty Hotep became a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. He was baptized in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Therefore, Betty Hotep has the talent, the good, which is imparted by Sister White to him, the founder of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But at the same time, Betty Hotep doubled his talents because he has the present truth, the new revelation in his lifetime. Now, let me ask you, does the only message that you have is the message imparted to you by Betty Hotep? Then, according to that reading, 2SR, page 93, then you have no additional light. When we accept the message of the Shepherd's Rod brought to us by Betty Hotep, our names is immediately written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Brothers and sisters, I would like to read that reading in track number 3. It says on page 8, at the moment we accept Christ as our personal Savior through the word of truth, at that supreme moment, God forgive us our sins, and the hands bloodstained by Calvary inscribe our names in the Lamb's Book of Life. Track number 3, page 8. But the only way that you can rest assured that your names will never be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life is to accept the new revelation, to accept the present truth revealed in our generation. That's what it means by double your talents. Because the statement in track number 3, I would like to read the statement in track number 3. On page 7, let us read the statement. That not every name, track number 3, page 7. That not every name that has been entered in the Lamb's books will be retained there is borne out with sad conclusiveness by the following scriptures. And the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever has sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. Exodus 32 verse 33. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. Revelation 22 verse 19. Track number 3, page 7. Now that reading is very plain. The prominent act by which our names will be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life is sinning against God. And I do fully believe that sinning against the Holy Ghost is the sinning against God. Now look at the statement in 2SR 198. Let's read 2SR page 198. The rejecting of light and present truth is the sin against the Holy Ghost. And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, present truth. Because that present truth is represented by the invisible Christ, the Spirit of Christ. I think that is also the same with the extra oil, because the oil represents the Holy Ghost in a form of a message. It says here, let us read again, it says, the rejecting of light and present truth is the sin against the Holy Ghost. And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, the present truth, it shall never be forgiven him. Neither in this world, neither in the world to come. Matthew 12:32. Our attitude towards present truth would either make a tree good and his fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and his fruit corrupt. For the tree is known by his fruit. Verse 33. Thus present truth has the power to change the individual and fit him for eternal life, which is the seal of the living God. Say Jesus, verily, verily I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. John 3 verse 5. Look at this statement in 1 TG number 5, page 18. 1 TG number 5, page 18. It says, you know for a fact, 1 TG number 5, page 18, you know for a fact that there is not one who names himself a Christian that talks outright against God. What professed Christians really do is say things against God's revealed truth, against present truth, without realizing that they are talking and sinning against the Holy Ghost, and thus against God himself too. To sin against the Holy Ghost is to sin against God. And that is the prominent act by which our names will be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life. Brothers and sisters, according to track number 3, page 7, sinning against God and rejecting present truth is sinning against the Holy Ghost. And then it says here in the next paragraph, 1 TG number 5, page 18. Even some present truth believers now and then drop a word of criticism, saying things by which to bolster their own reputation and down another's, or to win someone to their way of thinking at the expense of God's cause. These kinds of sins are the most insidious, and the greater the ability of the one that is engaged in such practices, the greater the damage. 1 TG number 5, page 18. And that is why the Shepherd's Rod plainly declared that, consequently, the greatest danger of the people in reality is not their listening to error, but their rejecting of present truth. Track number 3, page 10 and page 11. It says, consequently, the greatest danger of the people has not been their listening to error, but rather their rejecting present truth. Because to reject present truth is to sin against the Holy Ghost, and sinning against the Holy Ghost is letting our names be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life. And that is why, brothers and sisters, you remember our reading, the people who place themselves subject to be misled with this wholesale deception in 2SR 153, subject to be misled. So to reject present truth is we place ourselves subject to be misled, because that statement in 1 TG number 50, page 25, is pointing to the present truth. says here in 1 TJ number 50, page 25. Let's read the statement. 1 TJ number 50, page 25. This is the statement given by the voice of inspiration. We see that if we do not fall in love with the truth, deception is inevitable. It is explaining 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8 to 12, the portion by which Apostle Paul says, because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. The truth mentioned there is the present truth, the new revelation. Because according to 1 Ezra on page 123, 1 Ezra page 123, it says, Christ referred to water as a symbol of everlasting life. 1 Ezra page 123, it says, Christ referred to water as a symbol of everlasting life. The meaning of the symbol of drinking the water with the barley cakes is that souls were to be saved by its new truth, the spirit of life. So humanity will be saved only by its new truth in every generation in which they live. And that is represented by the spirit of life. 1 Ezra page 123. Now let's go back again to the reading here in 1 TJ number 50, page 25. We see that if we do not fall in love with the truth, deception is inevitable, meaning unavoidable. Because if you not love the truth, then you will reject the present truth. Then your names will be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life. Then deception, the wholesale deception, you cannot avoid anymore. Because the only one that can keep you escape on such wily snares of the devil is the power of the Holy Spirit, according to 2 Ezra 153. Now, how could you obtain that power when you are sinning against the Holy Spirit? Think it thoroughly, brothers and sisters. Now, let us read again. It says 1 TJ 50, 25. We see that if we do not fall in love with the truth, deception is inevitable. No, none are deceived by coming in contact with error. For we are in contact with it anyway from the time we are born to the time we die. But everyone who does not love the truth is sure to be deceived, regardless what he may do to avoid it. Regardless, once your names will be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life, you are only placing yourself subject to be misled. It says, regardless what you may do to avoid such deception, because you already forfeited the only medium by which you can escape such wily snares of the devil, brothers and sisters. And still, I do fully believe that accordingly, brothers and sisters, in such demon worship, there is 144,000 living saints that will not bow down, brothers and sisters. Why? Because their names had been retained in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now, I would like to read again on early writings, the vision of the prophet on page 38. I saw four angels who had a work to do on the earth and were on their way to accomplish it. Jesus was clothed with priestly garments. He gazed in pity on the remnant, then raised his hands and with the voice of deep pity cried, "My blood, Father, my blood, my blood, my blood." Then I saw an exceeding bright light come from God, who sat upon the great white throne and was shed all about Jesus. Then I saw an angel with a commission from Jesus, swiftly flying to the four angels who had a work to do on the earth, and waving something up and down in his hand and crying with a loud voice, "Hold, hold, 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 until the servants of God are sealed in their foreheads." I asked my accompanying angel the meaning of what I heard and what the four angels were about to do. He said to me that it was God that restrained the powers and that he gave his angels charge over things on the earth. That the four angels had power from God to hold the four winds and that they were about to let them go. But while their hands were loosening and the four winds were about to blow, the merciful eye of Jesus gazed on the remnant that were not sealed. And he raised his hands to the Father and pleaded with him that he had spilled his blood for them. Then another angel was commissioned to fly swiftly to the four angels and bid them hold until the servants of God were sealed with the seal of the living God in their foreheads. Now, this is the question. The vision of the prophet is very plain, that the merciful eye of Jesus gazed on the remnant that were not sealed. Why is it that the 144,000 living saints, they are already called remnant at the time by which they were not yet sealed? That is very plain in this vision in early writings, page 38. And the shepherd's rod defined the word remnant here in 1 SR 102. It says, what constitutes the remnant? The definition of remnant is that which is left after the separation, removal, or destruction of a part. So it says that the definition of the remnant, that which is left, either left after the separation, either left after the removal, or either left after the destruction. Now for sure, the 144,000 are called remnant. It is not because they were the only one that left after the destruction, because at that time they were not yet sealed. Before the 144,000 were completely sealed, for sure there was no destruction. So what does it mean by saying that they are already called remnant? What constitute the remnant? Now let's read another statement in the Shepherd's Rod 1 TG number 6, page 38. It says, only the holy ones, those whose names are left written in the book, escape the destruction that falls upon the wicked in the church. Only they constitute the remnant, the ones that are left. Now let us read again 1 TG number 6, page 38. Who constitute the remnant? And it says, only the holy ones, those whose names are left written in the book, escape the destruction that falls upon the wicked in the church. Only they constitute the remnant, the ones that are left. Now, think it thoroughly, brothers and sisters. Why is it that they are called remnant even before they were sealed? They are called remnant because their names retain in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now, these occurrences perfectly corroborating to the statement we read in 5 Answerer, page 30 and 31, that the first aspect of the judgment is bookworm. The first aspect of the judgment is bookworm. And I do fully believe that that statement in Bible commentary saying, strive with all your power to be among the living saints, brothers and sisters, or to that number 144,000, is to follow the admonition given in 2 TG number 7, page 10 and 11, brothers and sisters, saying, let us now make an effort to put our names in the Lamb's Book of Life. And since it was already predicted beforehand that the only names that will be left written among the living, because the Lamb's Book of Life is divided into two pages, the Book of the Dead and the Book of the Living. And the only ones whose names will be left written in the Lamb's Book of Life in the pages of the Book of the Living is the 144,000 living saints. Then to strive to be a part of that special company is to exert an effort to put our names be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. The admonition given in 2 TG number 7, page 10 and 11. Now, I would like to read 7 BC 970. Let us strive with all the power that God has given us. It is not our own power, but the power that God has given us to be among the 144,000. So, to strive is to do the utmost of the ability that had been given by God to us to let our names be written in the Lamb's Book of Life ineffaceably, the one written in tract number 518. And the shepherds had made it so plain that only those who doubled their talents, by which their names will no longer or will never be blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life. And the talents is the Lord's goods, and the Lord's goods is the present truth. Obviously, therefore, to have our names to have that most blessed assurance. What is assurance? The assurance that once you accept the present truth, your names will be forever retained in the Lamb's Book of Life. And you place yourself in absolute security, brothers and sisters, according to the voice of inspiration. Now, why is it that, brothers and sisters, the Shepherd's Rod emphasized clearly in 2 Esther 164 that to have the present truth is to have the knowledge when the judgment for the dead will close and when the judgment for the living begins. In 2 Esther 164. Now, I would like to read this reading first in 1 TG number 11, page 11. 1 TG number 11, page 11, it says, so only those who survive the judgment for the living in the house of God, 1 Peter 4:17, those whose names are not blotted out from the book will comprise the church, among whom are to be 144,000 sons of Jacob. And when Michael stands up, then those whose names, it says, are left in the book will be delivered from the trouble such as never was. They are the remnant, the ones who escape alive from the judgment for the living in the house of God. 1 TG number 11, page 11. That's why, brothers and sisters, to repeat again, our duty is only to proclaim this message. It is not our duty to convince anyone. I remember the statement, Testimonies for the Church, Volume 7. It says here, let us read the statement. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 7. And here the voice of inspiration is plainly telling, brothers and sisters, that our only duty is to proclaim this message. And page 35, Testimonies for the Church, Volume 7, page 35. Do not feel that the responsibility rests upon you to convict and convert the hearers. The power of God alone can soften the hearts of the people. You are to hold forth the word of life that all may have an opportunity of receiving the truth if they will. If they turn from the truth of heavenly origin, it will be their condemnation. I would like to read again, Volume 7, page 35. So that is our only duty. It says, do not feel that the responsibility rests upon you to convict and convert the hearers. The power of God alone can soften the hearts of the people. You are to hold forth the word of life that all may have an opportunity of receiving the truth if they will. If they turn from the truth of heavenly origin, it will be their condemnation. Here's another statement in Volume 7, page 159. It says, the divine teacher says, Volume 7, page 159, the divine teacher says, my spirit alone is competent to teach and to convict of sin. Externals make only a temporary impression upon the mind. I will enforce truth on the conscience, and men shall be my witness throughout the world, asserting my claims on man's time, his money, his intellect. All this I purchase on the cross of Calvary. Use my entrusted talents to proclaim the truth in its simplicity. Let the gospel be sent to all parts of the world, awakening burdened souls to inquire, what must I do to be saved? Now let us go back to our subject, brothers and sisters. Here in Unadventist Report Activities, I would like to read that reading. Let us read Unadventist Report Activities or Unadventist Activities Research Committee on page 14 and page 15. Let's read. It says, has the Lord no fresh truth, no meat in due season to meet the needs of His people at this particular time? I would like to quote that particular time, brothers and sisters, more pertaining to the judgment of the living. For example, let's read 2SR. B.T. Hotep used that term, particular time. 2SR, page 172. It says, 2SR, page 172. The song was sung in heaven by heavenly beings before the throne and before the beast and the elders. Therefore, it is evident that the judgment was in progress. Furthermore, further explanation to follow. Note that the 144,000 did not sing. But they only could learn the song as it was sung in heaven. That is, they alone understood the heavenly truth in that particular time and their position in connection with the message they must bear. They alone understood that heavenly truth in that particular time. The heavenly truth mentioned here, brothers and sisters, is the present truth. B.T. Hodge made it so plain that the comparison is with the dead. Here in 1 Symbolic Code, number 15, page 8. Let's read 1 Symbolic Code, number 15, page 8. It will be noted, 1 Symbolic Code, number 15, page 8. It will be noted that the shepherd's rod is stating this of the 144,000 in comparison with the dead and not with the great multitude. So the comparison is with the dead, showing that whatever this heavenly truth, it was not given unto them who experienced death. Only the living saints, they alone understood that heavenly truth in that particular time. And to repeat again, that is the present truth under the seventh seal. The final outpouring of present truth mentioned in Answerer number 1, page 90, can be applied only to the present truth under the seventh seal, being the last seal. Right? In 2 SR 202, the seventh being the last must concern the living. And the shepherd's rod says in 2 SR 215, as the six seals is pertaining to the six periods by which the saints are sealed, the seventh must also be applied to a sealing period. Otherwise, it cannot be called seventh seal. 2 SR 215. And we repeat several times, brothers and sisters, that the saints of God are sealed with present truth in all ages. And whatever that present truth is, that is the seal. But I would like to declare, brothers and sisters, that the statement, double their talents, I think it is more applicable to the living saints, 144,000. Because of all the saints, I think they are the only one by which B.T. Hodge declared that they have a double seal. Here in 1 SR page 29, the 144,000 having this seal are also marked, sealed by the angel of Revelation 7, which is the same as the one of Ezekiel 9. In other words, it may be termed a double seal. 1 SR page 29. Then this reading in 2 SR 172, completely telling us that there must be present truth in the judgment that pertains to the living, and in that particular time, they alone understood that heavenly truth, that present truth, and that present truth was not given by God to them who died, because the comparison is with the dead, according to 1 Symbolic Code, number 15, page 8. Now let us go back again to the reading in page 15 in Unadventist Activities Research Committee. Page 14 and 15. Has the Lord no fresh truth, no meat in due season to meet the needs of His people at this particular time? Has He forsaken the earth? And how will He judge the living without a message declaring that their cases are now to appear before God? Who will declare it? That their cases are now to appear before God. Who will declare it, brothers and sisters? The agency of God on earth, the spirit of prophecy, right? Now, let's read 2 TG number 12, page 29. It says here, 2 TG number 12, on page 29. The revelation, moreover, in the following verses, again and again, endeavors to make us see that the event there portrayed is the judgment in session. Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come. And I saw thrones, John declares, and judgment was given unto them. Revelation 20, verse 4. John truly penned it as a prophecy. But when it actually takes place, then God's agency on earth, the spirit of prophecy in the church, is to proclaim that the event has actually taken place. Who will proclaim it? It is the spirit of prophecy in the church. That is the gift of prophecy, the prophetic gift, God's inspired servant. He will be the one to proclaim that the event has taken place. Now let's go back again to the reading in Unadventist Activities Research Committee. Has the Lord no fresh truth, no meat in due season, to meet the needs of His people at this particular time? Has He forsaken the earth? And how will He judge the living without a message declaring that their cases are now to appear before God? And then it says, and how? us. Let's continue. It says, and how will we know when it comes if we keep our eyes and ears closed? If we do not change our present state of mind, how shall we believe even if we should accidentally hear that the message is come? Now I would like to read again. And how will we know when it comes if we keep our eyes and ears closed? If we do not change our present state of mind, how shall we believe even if we should accidentally hear that the message is come? Now, I would like to read the last portion. It says, would the judge of heaven condemn one without trial? And how shall he judge him without summons? I would like to read again. Would the judge of heaven condemn one without trial? And how shall he judge him without summons? In track number 9, page 34, it says, if an earthly judge does not convict and condemn a criminal without benefit of trial by jury, certainly then the all-just God of heaven will not. Now, I would like to read again. It says, track number 9, page 34. If an earthly judge does not convict and condemn a criminal without benefit of trial by jury, certainly then the all-just God of heaven will not. So it utters the impossibility that God will begin the proceedings that pertains to the living without sending summons. Brothers and sisters, that proceeding is illegal. That is very plain, brothers and sisters. And that is why the shepherd's rod made it so plain here in 2 Sr. 164. But when our high priest shall begin the atonement for the living, there must be a message of present truth. That is very plain. That God will not begin the atonement that pertains to the living unless God will send first present truth. Remember 11 symbolic code, number 3, page 5. Present truth comes only from God. Man does not know the seasons. Therefore, God himself will appoint the time when the present truth will be revealed. 11 symbolic code, number 3, page 5. And for sure, that present truth under the seventh seal, God will appoint it to be unfolded at the time when Jesus Christ will begin the atonement that intended for the living. But this reading in 2 Sr. 164, Jesus Christ will not begin the proceedings that pertains to the living without sending first the present truth. Because accordingly, in 1 Sr. page 28, the saints of God in all ages are sealed with present truth. And whatever that present truth is, that is the seal. Now, Jesus Christ will begin the atonement that pertains to the living without present truth. Then how could he be able to obtain the seal? Brothers and sisters, the seal is obtained in the holy place. Why? Because accordingly, in 2 Sr. page 184, it says, I would like to read again, it says, the virgins were called to meet him and thus by faith go in with him to appear before the Father, the great judge. The seal is the permit. It places their names in the Lamb's book of life and thus it grants to them the right to appear before the Father in judgment, not in person, but in figure, thus having their sins blotted out. 2 Sr. 184. The only one who could be able to enter into the most holy place are the saints, because only the saints receive the seal. Brothers and sisters, as a matter of fact, the shepherd's rod made it so plain that only the names of the righteous are brought into the presence of God. Because the only one who would enter the most holy place are those who have the permit. And what is the permit? In 2 Sr. 184, the seal of the living God. And to repeat again, that's what it means in 2 TG 42:31, by which the wise keeps in and the foolish keeps out. That door is the door into the most holy place that only the wise virgins had been able to enter therein because they obtained the seal of the living God. Brothers and sisters, I would like to read 2 TG 42, page 31. It says, and the cleansing he illustrates by a door which lets in the wise but keeps out the foolish. 2 TG 42, page 31. By which in the parable, the foolish virgins are knocking the door. When the door is closed, the door which is closed is the entrance to the most holy place. And the foolish virgins had not been able to enter. And at the time by which they tried to enter the door, Jesus Christ no longer opened the door. It is forever too late. But the fact is, when Jesus Christ entered the most holy place, He brings the names of the 144,000, indicating that when Jesus Christ entered to the most holy place, bringing the names of the 144,000, the foolish virgins were still alive, according to the parable, brothers and sisters. And the shepherds declared clearly here in Tuas are, let me read to you, here in Tuas are 183 and 184. Let's read the statement. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us. But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. As the foolish virgins at last came to the door, it is evident that they obtained the oil, meaning they learned of the message, but there had been a delay. The door was shut, and they were left out. Or in other words, the word delay is that they did not believe the message, not until it is forever too late to believe, brothers and sisters. Because I remember the statement in 1 TG number 12, it says here that, I would like to read that reading. 1 TG number 12, page 25, it says, Doubters as a rule wait until there is unquestionable evidence before they acknowledge that the message is from God. But it may not do them any good that late hour. I would like to read again. 1 TG number 12, page 25. Doubters as a rule wait until there is unquestionable evidence before they acknowledge that the message is from God. But it may not do them any good at that late hour. 1 TG number 12, page 25. So, let's read again. 2 SR 183. It says, As the foolish virgins at last came to the door, it is evident that they obtained the oil, meaning they learned of the message, or they already acknowledged the message. They acknowledged that the message cometh from God, but it is too late. It says, But there had been a delay. The door was shut, and they were left out. Now, why were they unconcerned at first and very zealous at last? The experience in this instance is about the same as that of the deluge. While Noah preached the coming of the flood, the world paid little attention to his message. But those who believed went into the ark at a given time, and the door was closed. But not long afterwards, signs of Noah's prediction appeared. And as drops of rain began to fall, the wicked multitude became alarmed and rushed for the ark. But the door was closed and they were left out. The door that was shut is a symbol showing that provision for the church had closed just shortly after the foolish virgins became alarmed. At last they were willing to pay the price and buy the oil, but it was not a change of heart. Only the fear of losing out. Their course of action had left them without the seal. The man with the writer's inkhorn had passed them by. What a terrible mistake. What a disappointment. Almost saved, but entirely lost. 2 SR page 183 and 184. It's hard to imagine to the people that almost saved, but entirely lost. I remember B.T. Hotep says in 1 SR that the disappointment of such a one is very hard to imagine, brothers and sisters. I would like to read here in 1 SR 185, it says, The disappointment to such a one would be greater than we can realize. The disappointment to such a one would be greater than we can realize. Experience only can tell the sorrow and grief at such a time. So only experience can tell the sorrow and grief at such a time. 1 SR page 185. Now let us read again, brothers and sisters, the statement in 2 SR 164. And then meditate on this reading in 2 SR page 164. It says, But when our high priest shall begin the atonement for the living, there must be a message of present truth. So the statement, there must be a message of present truth, plainly indicating that our High Priest Jesus Christ, He will never begin the proceedings that pertains to the living unless God will send present truth first. And that present truth is concerned the living, the present truth under the seventh seal. Sounding of the trumpet, urging everyone to lay hold on the Lamb of God, which is Jesus Christ, by which only can he in figure come to the sanctuary, confess his sin, and secure his life. This reading is easy to understand that such present truth had been sent by God at the time when God's people have still chance to confess their sins and to secure their lives. Because that is the focal point of the message of the present truth, sounding of the trumpet, urging everyone to lay hold on the Lamb of God, which is Jesus Christ, by which only can he in figure to come to the sanctuary, then confess his sin, and secure his life. And that's why here in 2SR page 219, the statement was, let's read, 2SR page 219. While the judgment for the living is in progress, so at the time when the judgment for the living is in progress, every sin must be confessed and put away. He who would neglect this great privilege will find himself involved in everlasting ruin, cut off from among his people. Ignoring this most vital subject would not profit us in the least. This reading plainly indicating that when the judgment for the living is in progress, there are people by which they were not yet cut off from among God's people. And the reason that they will be cut off because they neglect such great privilege. What privilege? To have knowledge concerning the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary. They just ignore it. This very vital subject, the most vital subject. And in the statement in 2SR page 183, it says, they paid little attention. They were unconcerned, brothers and sisters, concerning this knowledge. And hoping that we are among that people, brothers and sisters, by which they valued so much such revelation. I remember the reading here in Bible Commentary. Let's read Bible Commentary 4BC 11:39. 4BC 11:39. It says, the vision given to Isaiah represents the condition of God's people in the last days. And it says, they are privileged to see by faith the work that is going forward in the heavenly sanctuary. I would like to read again the statement. 4BC 11:39. The vision given to Isaiah represents the condition of God's people in the last days. And they are given, they are privileged to see by faith the work that is going forward in the heavenly sanctuary. Who are that people? Here in 1 TG number 27, page 6, it says here, 1 TG. Let's read the statement given by 1 TG 27, page 8. 1 TG number 27, page 8. It says, since this message announces that the great and dreadful day of the Lord is at hand, and we will prove to you that the great and dreadful day of the Lord is in strictest sense, in reality, is more pertaining to the first aspect of the judgment, the bookwork in the heavenly sanctuary. That is the proceedings in the holy place, the blotting out of names. We already explained that in the subject of the exceeding great horn, Daniel 8 verse 11 and 12, by which the focal point in reality is in the last and in the third period of the exceeding great horn, in the Protestant period, as stated in tract number 3, page 39, that the daily and the sanctuary will be trodden underfoot. And what does it mean by trodden underfoot? In tract number 4, page 26, it says that, no, it is not the sanctuary itself that had been trodden underfoot, but the place, meaning Christ's mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary, became obscured. That is the statement in tract number 4, page 26, saying, brethren, that note that the truth and the place, not the sanctuary itself, were cast down. That is, both Christ's truth and his place in the earthly sanctuary were set aside so that the knowledge as to his mediatorial work became obscured. But what place? The truth concerning the place of Christ's mediatorial work. The Bible is very plain. holy place, Matthew 24, verse 15, and also stated in 2 SR 131. Although we have a separate subject concerning about that brothers and sisters, but to repeat again, that is a very great day to the righteous when their names will be remain in the Lamb's Book of Life. But that is dreadful to the wicked when their names will be blotted out. And that is the reason that it is called the Great and Dreadful Day of the Lord. You know, the Great and Dreadful Day of the Lord, which is pertaining to the day of slaughter, that is executive judgment. It never been called as investigative judgment. The investigative judgment occurs in the heavenly sanctuary, that is bookwork transaction, brothers and sisters. The first aspect of the judgment. Now let's read again here in 1 TG 27, page 8. Since this message announces that the great and dreadful day of the Lord is at hand, that the judgment for the living is about to begin, and since Isaiah the prophet was given a vision of the Lord's moving into his temple for this judicial work that pertains to the living, the prophet experiences while he was yet in vision must therefore represent the experience of God's servants who are to announce the day of the Lord. His experience and commission must be our experience and commission. 1 TG number 27, page 8. Now, that is very plain, brothers and sisters, that this vision of Isaiah is pertaining to the time when the judgment for the living is about to begin. And of course, our commission is to sound this message so that the people will be alarmed and they will be prepared for that most important event, brothers and sisters, according to this reading. Although it was predicted beforehand that the foolish virgins will pay little attention to this message and they will unconcerned, brothers and sisters, but the time came that they will be very zealous to understand this message when the time is already too late for them, brothers and sisters. Now, let's read again here in 2 SR page 164. It says, but when our high priest shall begin the atonement for the living, there must be a message of present truth, sounding of the trumpet, urging everyone to lay hold on the Lamb of God, which is Jesus Christ, by which only can he in figure come to the sanctuary, confess his sin, and secure his life. Then it says, unless the close of the judgment for the dead and the commencement for the living be made known to us, we would have no present truth while the judgment for the living is in session. Neither would such judgment be legal or just. He who fails to respond to the heavenly summons will be left without the seal or covering of God, and therefore must be cut off from among his people, as prefigured by the services in the typical day of atonement. 2 SR page 164. Now first, 100%, this heavenly summons will be served during the sealing of the 144,000. Because the statement says, he who fails to respond to the heavenly summons will be left without the seal of the living God. Then for sure, he who responds to the heavenly summons will be sealed with the seal of the living God, because there is no neutral position. Plainly indicating that this heavenly summons, brothers and sisters, to repeat again, it will be served during the time by which the saints are to be sealed. And only those who responded to the heavenly summons will receive the seal of the living God. But those who failed to respond to the heavenly summons will be left without the seal of the living God in their foreheads or covering of God. That is very plain in this reading, 2 SR 164. And we know summons. Summon cometh from the presiding judge at chamber, but it is heavenly summons. It cometh from God the Father. And heavenly summons, it is a message, a letter to inform the such accused one, brothers and sisters, he need to appear in the court, brothers and sisters, to face in the judgment, brothers and sisters, concerning the case by which he was allegedly accused. Now, we know the accuser of the brethren is Satan. We have been accused by Satan. Now, here the shepherd's rod is emphasizing for sure that our advocator, our lawyer to defend our case, which is Jesus Christ, cannot depend our case if we will not respond to that heavenly summons. Although He guaranteed us that He could be able to win our case, even if it is the worst. But the only thing that our advocator is requesting us to respond to that heavenly summons. Otherwise, we will be left without the seal of God, meaning Jesus Christ cannot protect us. Because the only protection, brothers and sisters, is the seal of the living God. Then this heavenly summons is what constitutes as a part of the present truth under the seventh seal. For the shepherd's rod plainly declared that unless the close of the judgment for the dead and the commencement for the living be made known to us, that is pointing to the heavenly summons, by which the heavenly summons cometh from God, cometh from heaven. It is a knowledge telling us when the judgment for the dead will close and when the judgment for the living begins. That unless, think it thoroughly, unless the close of the judgment for the dead and the commencement for the living be made known to us, we would have no present truth while the judgment for the living is in session. But that is impossible, because in the upper portion it says that when Jesus Christ, our high priest, shall begin the proceedings, the atonement that pertains to the living, there must be a message of present truth. That is in absolute necessity, that Jesus Christ will not begin the proceedings that pertains to the living, the judgment that pertains to the living, without the present truth. Because only the present truth by which the saints are to be sealed. I repeat that several times in 1 SR page 28. The saints of God in all ages without exemption are sealed with present truth. And whatever that present truth is, that is the seal. So since the seventh period is also a sealing period, according to 2 SR 215, then as the sixth seal, it says, as the six seals have reference to six periods in which the saints were sealed, the seventh must also apply to a sealing period. Otherwise, it cannot be called seventh seal. And concerning the seventh seal, that sealing period is concerned the living. It says 202, 2 SR. But the seventh sealing period, being the last, must concern the living. Therefore, that present truth is concerned the living. And that is why in the statement in 2 SR 172, brothers and sisters, I would like to use the term that statement in 2 SR page 172, brothers and sisters, saying, the song was sung in heaven by heavenly beings before the throne and before the beast and the elders. Therefore, it is evident that the judgment was in progress. It says, note that the 144,000 did not sing, but they only could learn the song as it was sung in heaven. That is, they alone understood the heavenly truth in that particular time and their position in connection with the message they must bear. Now, since, brothers and sisters, the shepherd's rod says here, I would like to read in track number 3, it says here in track number 3, page 13, since earthly beings themselves, having never been in heaven, are naturally strangers to heaven's realities, 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9, then in order for God to make heavenly truth known unto them, He must reveal it by means of earthly realities with which they are familiar. Now, I would like to illustrate to you in earthly realities by which we are familiar. I think, although I am not really familiar, I think majority throughout the whole world, that the proceedings in the court, on the earthly court, before they will begin, there is an opening song. And that is, I think, the national anthem or their national anthem. If it is the court in the United States of America, that is the national anthem in the United States of America. Now, these heavenly beings, in this instance, when they began to sing, that is already the proceedings that pertains to the living saints. And that is why it says, note that the 144,000 did not sing. The one singing is the heavenly beings in the heavenly sanctuary, but they only could learn the song. They learned that song is already an opening song for the proceedings of the judgment that pertains to the living, and they understood that heavenly truth in that particular time, which is the judgment that pertains to the living, that is already the commencement of the judgment that pertains to the living. And that is why, brothers and sisters, to repeat again and again, the statement says in 2 SR 164, unless the close of the judgment for the dead, now there must be an absolute knowledge that God will bestow unto His servants that the judgment for the dead is close, and then the judgment for the living is commencing. The statement in 2 SR 202, I would like to read, it says, as there are seven seals in consecutive order, it is clear that our world's history is divided into seven different periods. The judgment begins with the first and ends with the last. Evidently, the first six seals complete the cases of those who were dead preceding the judgment and while it is in session. So that statement, it is already in session, but in reality, the judgment did not as yet begin. It pertains, I would like to use the term, the opening song. The opening song, the judgment is already in session. But, brothers and sisters, the proceedings did not yet begin. While it is in session, preceding the judgment, the actual, and it is pertaining to the blotting out of names. Brothers and sisters, blotting out of names. And we will study that in the subject, silence. There is silence in heaven when the names of the wicked have been blotted out. The only silence that familiar to the Bidian, I know that is during the 7 days, is slaughtering. But the fact is, no, that is not the only silence in the heavenly sanctuary. Let us dig deeper, brothers and sisters. Now let us go back again to the reading in 2 SR 164. Remember, brothers and sisters, the statement in 2 SR page 220, it says, is there any way whereby we can determine the time of the opening of the seal and the commencement of the judgment for the living? If God so faithfully revealed to the living the commencement of the judgment for the dead, it can be possible that He would keep secret the time of the judgment for the living. If He did, we would have no present truth in the time of the last seal. Neither could there be justice in such secrecy, nor could such judgment be legal. Therefore, a revelation of the judgment for the living is of as great importance as the revelation of the gospel itself. For the judgment, blotting out the sins, is the crowning act in the gospel of Christ. Thus we conclude that when the seal is open and the judgment for the living begins, we must know it. The Day of Atonement in its time proves the same, for the Israelites were well informed of the event, their duty, and the consequence. Brothers and sisters, I invite you to read this paragraph seriously and honestly and sincerely. Now, the shepherd's rod made it so plain. If He did, what does it mean if He did? If God would keep secret the time of the commencement of the judgment for the living, we would have no present truth in the time of the last seal. So what does it mean if there is no present truth in the last seal? First, this reading plainly indicate that the present truth under the last seal had not been bestowed by God to Bethehotep. Because if the judgment for the living, the commencement of the judgment for the living, will not be made known to God's people, then they have no present truth in the last seal. And since Bethehotep, he has no knowledge when the judgment for the living begins, either exact or approximate, then for sure, the present truth under the last seal, the seventh seal, was not bestowed by God to Bethehotep. Because the present truth under the last seal, the sign that it was already bestowed and given by God, is to have the knowledge when the judgment for the dead will close and the judgment for the living begins. Because unless that knowledge be bestowed unto us, we would have no present truth under the last seal. Not only that we will have no present truth under the last seal, such judgment is not legal. Think it thoroughly, brothers and sisters. So what is the absolute answer? Is there any way whereby we can determine the time of the opening of the seal and the commencement of the judgment for the living? Of course, the answer, there is. There is an absolute way, brothers and sisters. Because if there is no possibility of knowing when the judgment for the living begins and when the judgment for the dead will close, then Jesus Christ will begin the atonement that pertains to the living without present truth. Because that is the statement, unless the close of the judgment for the dead and the commencement for the living be made known to us, then we would have no present truth. Well, the judgment for the living is in session. But that is an impossible thing. God guaranteed. Because if God would keep secret the time, then it is injustice and such judgment is illegal. Saying that the commencement of the judgment for the living and the close of the judgment for the dead, there was a period of time by which God keep it secret, but not all the time. The reason only that God keep it secret because that is not the appointed time to reveal such proceedings, to reveal such knowledge, because they are not the people intended for such knowledge, because such knowledge is intended only to the living saints, because they are the people who must know that their cases are on trial. Now, let me ask you a simple question. That statement in 2 TJ 12:30, saying to the people, the living, that they need to know that their cases are on trial. Now, how will they know that their cases are on trial? How? In what way? Now, if God will not reveal the commencement of the judgment that pertains to the living, then how will they know that their cases are on trial? And would you think they will be subject to penalty? For example, on an earthly tribunal, earthly court, you will be charged as contempt of the court, that you did not appear to the court when your cases are on trial, while in reality, the court did not send any summons to you to let you know that you have a case pending in that court. It is illegal and also injustice. And also, brothers and sisters, what an absurdity. So the statement in 2 TJ 12:30, to the people who must know that their cases are on trial, the only one that will inform them to let them know that their cases are on trial is Jesus Christ, our lawyer, our advocator. And Jesus Christ will channel such revelation through his agency on earth. And that is the prophetic gift, as stated in 2 TJ 12:29. Brothers and sisters, that is very plain. Here in 2 TJ number 12, page 29, let us read again the statement. The revelation, moreover, is in the following verses again and again, endeavors to make us see that the event there portrayed is the judgment in session. What judgment? The judgment that pertains to the living. And what is the statement in 2SR? When the judgment of the dead is completed, you remember the statement in 2SR, page 202? Let us read again. It says, evidently, the first six seals complete the cases of those who were dead preceding the judgment. So, the judgment that pertains to the dead is closed, brothers and sisters, and then the judgment that pertains to the living is already in session, but the actual judgment did not as yet commence. And what does it mean? That's what it means in 2SR 172. The heavenly beings is already singing, meaning the judgment is in session, that is the opening song, to indicate that the judgment that pertains to the living is already in session, because the judgment that pertains to the dead, brothers and sisters, is already close. The judgment that pertains to the dead is close, then while the judgment that pertains to the living is already in session, but preceding the judgment, meaning the actual judgment did not as yet commence, but the judgment that pertains to the living is in session, because that song is an opening song that the session already commencing, but the actual judging did not as yet commence. And only the 144,000 learned that song, that song is an opening song to the proceedings of the judgment that pertains to the living. And the shepherd's rod says here in 2 TJ 12:29, it says, John truly penned it as a prophecy, but when it actually takes place, then God's agency on earth, the spirit of prophecy in the church, is to proclaim that the event has actually taken place. What is God's agency on earth? The spirit of prophecy. What is that spirit of prophecy? That is the gift of prophecy. That is the inspired human channel, right? In tract number 643, have you not yet discovered, tract number 6, page 43, have you not yet discovered, whether it be ancient or modern times, all the Bible truths are discovered only through the inspired human channel, the spirit of prophecy. Think it thoroughly, brothers and sisters, and hoping that you will not lose your time, brothers and sisters, in this very important event, the coming of Christ, the invisible coming of Christ, which is pertaining to the judgment that pertains to the living. Because the first coming of Jesus Christ, the first invisible coming of Jesus Christ, occurred in October 22, 1844. And the shepherd's rod says, if God so faithfully revealed to the living the commencement of the judgment that pertains to the dead, then there is no reason that God would hide it. There is no reason that God would not reveal the commencement of the judgment that pertains to the living, by which in reality, that is the focal point of the judgment. Because that is the state in Jezreel letter number 2, page 2. That is only the groundwork, the revelation of Christ coming to the most holy place in October 22, 1844, the commencement of the judgment that pertains to the dead. In reality, it does not profited to the people who were already dead, because how could they know that their cases are on trial when they were lying unconscious in their graves, according to answerer number 3, page 6. Because the proceedings in October 22, 1844, is not the cases of Sister White. It is the cases under the first seal, and then next, the second seal. And those people were already dead. And the only reason that God revealed that knowledge is to serve as groundwork, according to tract number 5, page 34. Fulfilled prophecies are seen, therefore, employed by the scriptures as groundwork to that prophecies which is yet to be fulfilled. That is only groundwork. The focal point is the judgment that pertains to the living. We need to know that our cases are on trial. Because the angel, brothers and sisters, is not sent. That is the statement, General Conference Special in page 39. I would like to remind again, General Conference Special, page 39. It says, in fact, the three angels' messages are applicable to the judgment for the dead only indirectly, for the judgment for the living is the all-important event. That is, the angel, the messenger, is not sent particularly to explain what the judgment does to the dead, but what it is to do to the living. General Conference Special, page 39. So, that is not the particular object in view. And that's why in Jezreel letter, brothers and sisters, Jezreel letter number 2, on page 2, it says here, let's read a statement, on Jezreel letter number 2, on page 2, now since the message of the judgment for the living is of far greater importance than the message of the judgment for the dead, it is but expected that the Bible will have more to say about the latter than the former. This is so because the judgment for the living has to do with the living themselves, with the message bearers rather than with the dead. In importance, therefore, there is no comparison between the two. How will we get the message of the judgment for the living? The answer is clear to all. We will get it in the same way we got the one in 1844. Since it then came through inspiration, through God's own chosen instrumentality, it is certain that the additional message is to come in the same way, that is, by inspiration, through God's own chosen agency. Indeed, truth is never revealed in any other way but by inspiration. Jezreel letter number 2, page 2. God's agency. What is God's agency? Human inspired instrumentality. The same way, if in the judgment that pertains to the dead, there are two inspired servants, William Miller and Ellen G. White, then we can easily understand that in the judgment that pertains to the living, there must also be two inspired servants, antitypical Elijah Gentile Baptist, which is B.T. Hotep, and antitypical Elijah the Tisbite. Brothers and sisters, to repeat again, the present truth under the seventh seal, this knowledge had not been bestowed by God to B.T. Hotep. Different angles, and it is only a foolishness. I think the same statement that I would like to borrowed that statement given by B.T. Hotep in General Conference Special, brothers and sisters, on page 39, saying that, I would like to read this statement, in viewing of these facts, it would be stupidity of the lowest form, if not blasphemy, for anyone. I would like to use that term. In view of these facts, it would be stupidity of the lowest form, if not blasphemy, for anyone to declare. I would like to use the term to declare that the present truth under the seventh seal, the present truth under the last seal had been bestowed by God to Pithihotep, brothers and sisters, because it is tantamount to declare that God did not know that Pithihotep will die. If God himself already declared that the present truth under the seventh seal, this revelation must be given only to the saints that will no longer to taste death. Now it happens that God accidentally had been able to give that present truth to Pithihotep, is tantamount to declare that God did not know everything. Brothers and sisters, this present truth under the seventh seal never been bestowed by God to Pithihotep. And the strongest proof that this present truth under the seventh seal was not bestowed by God to Pithihotep is he himself has no knowledge when the judgment for the dead will close and the judgment for the living begins, even exact or approximate, right? That is the statement in Answerer number 1, page 94. It says here, in the statement in question, the rod has no reference to the investigative judgment. The message sets no date, either exact or approximate, for the closing of the judgment of the dead or for the beginning of the judgment of the living. But that rod is concerning the rod of in the first section, led by Moses, not in the last section. Because in the last section, brothers and sisters, God commanded the servant to measure the temple, the altar, and the worshiper. And that is pertaining to the proceedings. That to measure is to number, both in time, brothers and sisters. And it is illogical that God commanded that servant to measure, while in reality, God himself did not give him the information concerning such proceedings. So I invite all our valued listeners and viewers to focus their attention in this very important subject, because in our next episode, I will explain it in details, brothers and sisters, how our God revealed this information unto us concerning when the judgment that pertains to the dead will close and the judgment that pertains to the living begins. It doesn't matter whether you believe it or not, because our only responsibility is to proclaim the message. Because if we will not proclaim this message, we'll be held responsible for such revelation that had been committed by God unto us. But to convict and convert anyone, that is not our prerogative. That is only belongs to God and belongs to His Spirit. So, brothers and sisters, to repeat again, this is episode number 4 concerning the time prophecy, and I've decided to focus to the time prophecy that pertains to the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary, concerning the proceedings in the holy place, which is the blotting out of names. We will continue this subject, brethren, and hoping the good Lord will bless you. Thank you very much for listening. Have a wonderful evening.